When Calgary journalist and author Andrew Nikiforuk sees someone cutting the grass or washing clothes, he sees servitude. In his latest book, Nikiforuk makes the argument that the way we use and abuse cheap oil is equivalent to the practice of slaveholding. And like slaveholders, we have morally and ethically compromised ourselves in our pursuit of an opulent lifestyle. What's needed, he says, is a new global abolitionist movement. Andrew Nikiforuk has written about the oil industry for more than 20 years. His new book is called The Energy of Slaves, Oil and the New Servitude. And he is with me in Calgary. Good morning.
Good morning, Jim.
Now, before we talk about oil and slavery, I'd like to get from you a sense of just how much oil has changed our lives over the past century and a half.
Well, oil is embedded in just about everything we purchase and buy. You know, 85% of the energy we employ to get different things done all comes from fossil fuels, and the majority of that is still coming from oil. Oil has changed agriculture. Machines fueled by oil have depopulated rural communities and resulted in a food supply that produces enormously cheap stuff, but at the same time that can also be thoroughly contaminated with all sorts of things. Oil has changed the scale and size of cities, and our cities are now designed not so much for people as they were in the Middle Ages, but are really designed around the machines that serve us in cities, particularly cars. Mm-hmm. Right? Oil has changed economic thinking. Until oil came around, particularly cheap oil, this whole idea of exponential linear growth was pretty much a foreign phenomenon. Oil has allowed us to think about economics as though energy doesn't matter. We're now learning that that is a critical mistake. And then oil has really changed politics. I mean, the United States was the world's first oil pioneer. And in the 1920s and 1930s, the United States was really the Saudi, you know, it was Texas was Saudi Arabia and California was Kuwait and you had Louisiana and Oklahoma. The whole American experience, which, you know, this phenomenal economic joyride was largely conditioned by oil. And you can't really understand the problems that the United States has today without, first of all, recognizing that it was the world's first petrostate. You know, so it's changed everything.
It's interesting the way you said oil has touched basically everything. As I was reading your book, I was trying to think at one point if there were any aspects of our lives that hadn't been influenced by oil. And you've pretty well got everything in there. You've got religion in there. You've got sports in there. You've raising our families. It's not just the big stuff that you would think about, our cities and the corporate agriculture systems that have developed and that kind of thing and petrostates. But there are no small aspects of our lives that haven't been touched by oil.
No, none. No. I mean, oil is as essential. In fact, oil is more essential to North American everyday life than owning a slave was to a Roman. We kind of take it all for granted because it was so cheap and so abundant.
Well, let's talk about this analogy that you make in the book that sort of underpins the entire book. You argue that easy access to oil resources is analogous to slavery. Make that connection for us.
Well, I mean, people forget that slavery was first and foremost an energy institution. I mean, shackling human muscle was all about getting work done, and any number of civilizations have deployed that form of energy to accumulate wealth and get a whole bunch of stuff done. The Romans in particular probably took it to its most extreme form. And they used slaves for agriculture. They used in Sicily and in southern Italy, plantations were just packed with thousands of slaves growing grain and other crops for the empire. And then the average sort of middle class or wealthy Roman family also, you know, grew very dependent on slaves too. And these slaves, you know, performed the same kind of very specific functions that, you know, a dishwasher or an oven or a furnace would perform today. You know, there would be somebody whose job was to, you know, get the hearth going in the morning. Another whose job was to bake the bread. Another job was to serve a certain kind of dish to his master. Another had the job simply of accompanying his master down the streets of Rome and to remind him of all the names of the important people that he passed on the street.
So that was the BlackBerry sort of, slave.
The BlackBerry or iPod, you know. Yeah, that's and what's really incredible is that both the Greeks and the Romans actually regarded their slaves as speaking tools. They didn't recognize them as human beings, but as speaking tools, as technology, or what we would call technology today. And slaves were socially dead. They did not have a life outside of slavery. And so what I'm arguing is that our bad habits and assumptions about energy were formed very much by our experience with slavery, and that we took those attitudes and bad habits and plopped them right down on hydrocarbons as a feedstock for energy slaves or machines. So let's start with the first example would be simply coal feeding the steam engine. And the steam engine was a remarkable development that had an enormous capacity to do work and could replace thousands and thousands of laboring men.
Mm-hmm.
And then with oil, you know, all right, here's even a better hydrocarbon with even a greater capacity to do work, then gets deployed in a whole variety of other energy slaves, in particular cars and then lawnmowers. And then cheap oil encouraged us to find a way to use oil for just about everything. The first American to raise some interesting questions about this was Buckminster Fuller. And Buckminster Fuller, you know, the father of the geodesic dome and a really quirky, interesting scientist, American scientist, wrote in Fortune magazine, no less, in 1940 about the American experience, how exceptional it was. And one of the reasons it had become so exceptional was that the fact that the average American had access to more energy slaves than any other people on the planet.
Mm-hmm.
So, and he figured his calculations based on energy data from the British military and the U.S. military was that the average American at that point had 39 energy slaves at their disposal, fired by both coal or by oil. You know, and today the figure is around 89.
Mm-hmm.
So that explains an awful lot about why the United States became the great economic power it did, because its people had, by extension of their energy slaves, this enormous ability to do all kinds of work and to enjoy all kinds of comforts.
So in making this connection, what's the larger point you're trying to make?
I guess the larger point I'm trying to make is the one that Ivan Illich raised in the 1970s. And he was a Catholic theologian. He wrote a marvelous book called Energy and Equity in 1973, which was published in Le Monde. And he said, we've got a problem here because how many energy slaves, number one, are we entitled to? Why are we tolerating this great inequity between North Americans, Europeans, and the rest of the world in terms of energy slaves at their disposal? And if the whole condition of being a master and employing slaves dramatically affected the moral, social, and well-being of masters, then is it not proper for us to review our relationship with energy slaves? In other words, he's saying the more slaves you have at your command, the less free you will actually be, the less competent you will be, and the more moral challenges you will have as you will deploy all of this power that at your fingertips. And I think that's the central question. You know, what slavery really demonstrated is that we don't really know how to use energy wisely and that we can be incredibly abusive and barbaric when – even when that energy is in the form of a human being in our own house, we can do horrific things to that individual. And we find now that with all of the power we have with hydrocarbons and energy machines that we're not doing horrific things to other people necessarily. But we are doing horrific things to waterways, to forests, to our atmosphere, to our oceans that wouldn't have been possible before had we not had access to this amount of power. So the real issues are moral and philosophical. Do we know how to use energy wisely?
So then are we morally compromised in some way when we get in our car and turn it on, when we mow our lawn, when we wash our clothes?
Well, the question that we really it comes back to, how many slaves are we using and what are we using them for? And of course, because oil is the dominant energy institution, we're not really given a lot of choices at this point in time. You know, if you're somebody that chooses to walk, or somebody that chooses to conserve energy in various ways, you're still regarded as a bit of a crank. And you know, what's the matter with you? Why don't you enjoy all these comforts? And but we've got the same problems that slaveholders have almost always had. You know, when you've got a lot of slaves at your command, I mean, you tend to get a little bit fat. You tend to get a little bit lazy. You tend to get a little bit incompetent because there's not much you do for yourself anymore. You just employ all these slaves to do it. And you also tend to become phenomenally in debt. And this is the characteristic that most North Americans share with most slaveholders, is that you go more and more in debt to buy more and more energy slaves, supposedly to make yourself or your family much more comfortable, when quite often actually what you're really doing is making your life much more complex. And that, you know, after a while it becomes really difficult to manage 89 slaves in your household 24/7, and you've got to ask, okay, well, you know, maybe I don't need all these guys in my house. You know, maybe I can be healthier, happier, and in fact, the research all suggests this, that the fewer slaves you employ, the more vital and happier you actually are.
But I think a lot of people listening this morning would think it's a bit of a stretch to draw some sort of moral equivalency between me washing my clothes and a Roman slave owner or a plantation owner in pre-Civil War southern U.S. I mean, what about the argument that this is a bit of an oversell, that kind of moral equivalency is a bit of a stretch?
I don't believe it is, but we have to look at the broader picture here. Okay, if running my washing machine and running my car and my lawnmower and being really careless about how I spend all this energy is playing a fundamental role in terms of polluting the atmosphere and changing the energy balance of that atmosphere and resulting in something as dramatic as climate change, you've got a moral problem. And if employing all these slaves collectively on a scale that really makes very little sense anymore, and that is having a profound impact on the quality of water, on the biological diversity, on the health of our oceans, these are all fundamentally huge moral issues. Am I taking part in an energy and economic system whose complexity is so profound and so gross at this point in time that it's having difficulty responding to real issues that are all about the survival of the species on this planet?
But of course, these people are also taking part in a system that they're political leaders, they're business leaders, in many cases they're religious leaders, intellectuals are telling them is the proper and right and appropriate way to go. That we are a consumer society, that's how progress happens, that spending is what we must continue to do.
And this is exactly the same point that the defenders of slavery made. They said, well, you know, wait a moment. Now, you know, and they would be responding to the abolitionists who said, well, you know, maybe slavery is not such a good thing. And they would say, maybe it's a mortal sin. And their response was, no, wait a moment, how can you say that? I mean, you drink tea, don't you? If you drink tea and you put sugar in your tea, who raised that sugar? It was a slave. And by the way, what kind of clothes have you got on your back there, Jim? Is that cotton? Well, who picked that cotton? And if you're smoking a cigar, well, you know, who picked that tobacco? And the slaveholders used exactly, and slave traders used exactly the same arguments. And what's interesting is that whatever the dominant energy institution is for any society, if you start raising questions about it, you know, you know, the reply always is, well, you can't raise those questions because you're using some of that energy, right?
Now, of course, oil is always in the news. Energy is always in the news. But generally, we focus—
And we'll be more so as it becomes more and more expensive, right?
And generally, though, our focus is on things like pipelines and whether we should be doing business with China, that kind of thing. What should we be focusing on? What should the conversation around oil and energy sound like?
The conversation should really start asking these fundamental moral and philosophical questions. Okay, we've climbed high up the energy ladder. We have this very sophisticated, complicated society. where we tend to think that every solution to our problems can be solved by deploying more high-energy technologies. And I think that's a dead end. And I think we really need to start asking ourselves, well, how much energy do we really need? How many energy slaves? You know, we need something to do some heavy lifting. I mean, I think everyone would agree with that. I think everyone would agree, yes, we'd want some degree of comfort in our lives. We don't want to live in caves. But what's equitable? What's just? What do we actually really need? We need to ask some serious questions about waste. I mean, so, you know, oil and mechanized agriculture has produced a lot of cheap food that is grossly contaminated, and we throw out about a third of it. Well, you know, what civilization does that? So by addressing these fundamental issues about how much energy we use, how much we're entitled to, and by embracing the idea that we can actually be much happier by employing less and by getting rid of some of these energy slaves in our lives, we can be much more vital and productive.
Yeah, you actually make the point in one of your chapters, Oil and Happiness, that energy consumption doesn't necessarily make people happy, that often people in third world countries rate themselves as happier than us, despite the fact that they're consuming a tenth of energy.
And those folks are living more off the energy of their family or the energy of their community, are simply the energy of love, you know. So it's a totally different perspective. You know, we have lost a lot of that.
But the fact that at the same time, China, India, they're industrializing at a pace like we've never seen before. How does that change this whole equation?
Well, they want to go on the joyride too. And in many ways, I can't blame them. I mean, they've looked what has been the model? The model is, well, you take all this energy, you spend it like hell, flood your household with cheap stuff, and then start taking drugs because you're not very happy. But that's the experience both India and China want to repeat, and probably will do so with disastrous consequences because there isn't enough cheap stuff, oil, around to fund it all.
People don't like having things taken away from them. They don't like someone telling them that they can no longer buy the car of their dreams or upgrade their television or get a new Apple product. Eventually, though, you say we're going to hit a point where it's no longer a choice. It's necessity. We have to change the way we do things. What is that point? Where's the tipping point? Is it when oil hits $200 a barrel?
I'm not sure where the tipping point will be, but there was quite a fascinating American sociologist by the name of Fred Cotterill, who wrote a great book about energy in 1955, and he updated it in 1972. And he made all kinds of really wise observations about what happens to a society as they become progressively hooked on more energy, and they start climbing the energy ladder, and, you know, and life is looking brighter and more comfortable. Cotterill also said, look, well, you know, you're not going to give this up willingly, are you? No, it's not going to happen. So he said, what will happen? Well, coming down the energy ladder then is not going to be easy. We're not going to choose to do it, but events will force us to do it. So either oil is going to become so grotesquely expensive, or there will be other crises that we will have to do with in terms of oil-based infrastructure being wiped out by climate change and other energy imbalances in the atmosphere. That will be the tipping point for us where we will begin to go in a different direction. Cotterill also felt, too, that going up the energy ladder, there was an enormous amount of social and political protest. There were two world wars. There were the killings of millions and millions of people. You know, it was a fairly dramatic ascent. He felt the descent would also be equally dramatic and equally conflict-ridden. And he think that the really serious issue he felt, too, was that, you know, governments got big on cheap energy just as corporations got heavily concentrated and became these monopolies, really, on cheap energy. And that we're going to see, as the price of energy changes, we're going to see a real constriction and contraction of both government and corporations. And I think we're beginning to see a lot of that right now in Europe and in the United States and in Japan. And now we're really beginning to see these places, they're not growing because they can't afford much more energy to do so. And we're beginning to see the contraction of all kinds of government services, as well as contraction of the economy. And what is surprising a great many Europeans is how conflict-laden this whole process is. You know, when you look at a successful movement like abolition, which changed an energy system, but it was also supported by hydrocarbons, let's be honest about that. But that was a faith-based system. And I do not think, or faith-based movement, I don't think that we're going to get people cutting back on their energy slaves and making a concerted effort in using energy appropriately and wisely without a faith-based movement that says, you know what, this is wrong, what you're doing. We don't have the right to change the energy balance in the atmosphere and to place, you know, the whole life system of the planet in peril. We don't have a right to acidify the oceans. We don't have a right to destroy river deltas. We don't have a right to build huge monstrous cities that we cannot sustain when the cheap energy supplies that built them have disappeared. We need some kind of movement that pushes these moral issues forward in a way that says, you know what, we can do better. As human beings, we can exercise some prudence, some wisdom, and some morality in terms of how we use energy.
Now, you make the case that a reduced consumption is really the only solution to this. And I think a lot of listeners will probably want us to touch on, at least briefly, alternative energy sources. Yeah. What about solar power? What about wind energy? Do you see that playing any kind of a significant role in this?
I think they're all important sources of energy, but we have to recognize their limitations and their ability or capacity to do work. They don't have the same capacity to do work that hydrocarbons do. And if we deploy wind and solar and geothermal on the same kind of industrial scale and framework that we have deployed oil and natural gas and coal, then we're going to be in deep trouble. We won't be able to do it, number one. We haven't got the oil energy to build all that stuff, and we're just going to be in a mess. We have to recognize that the limits of renewables. You know, so wind is intermittent. You've only got it 40% of the time. You need cold-fired backup for it. Solar is a great resource, and we're still developing technologies there. And I think there are many things that can be done with solar on small scale. But all of the alternatives come, you know, would come with limitations in terms of the amount of energy it takes to make them and the amount of energy return we get from them. So then that comes back then, all right, so what is the solution? And, you know, Jeff Rubin, a really smart economist, he talks about the new green being all about, you know, using less hydrocarbons. Vaclav Smil, who's, you know, probably one of the world's foremost energy analysts, intellectual treasure for this country, hardly ever sourced in this country, though, at the University of Manitoba. He says, look, where do we go with all this? Well, we have to get a lot smarter. We need, you know, we need high-efficient furnaces. We need high-speed trains. We need and we need to really encourage reduced consumption. This materialism is not good for us. This spending of all this cheap stuff, this is not good for us as a people. So let's get some discipline. Let's get some direction. And let's start reducing.
Andrew, thank you very much.
Thank you, Jim.